Welcome back to the show.
It's lovely to be back. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for being here. I remember last time. It's a legendary show when you were on last time because
yeah.
because suddenly I have this guest, you, kissing another guest.
Yes.
You didn't really know her.
No, I didn't know her.
It was just
I don't know why I did it.
Of the moment.
I really didn't know why I did it.
It
wasn't just like that. But basically, what she said was, when I kiss people, I see colours.
Well,
was it that?
Something, yes.
Oh, don't come on, stick up for me. Well, I didn't just randomly kiss her for no reason. Well, you're not doing me any favours at the beginning of this. This interview's not kicking off well.
We've been talking about sleep, about sleeping.
Yes, very important.
And you are actually very into that.
I'm totally into it now. Yeah. Mate, I'm so into sleep.
Yeah, but you sleep well, finally.
Well, that's debatable. I think I used to do it badly. For 6 years, I was getting about 3 to 4 hours sleep.
Was it that you couldn't sleep or that you just
didn't
want to sleep?
No, I could sleep now. But it was that I just had so much to do. There's so many excuses in modern-day life to not go to bed. And now I treat... Honestly, the two things I treat as work... All my work is pleasure, joy, hobby. My job in life now is get to bed on time and eat your breakfast. And that's it. That's the only things I have to really try hard to do.
So what's on time?
Well, I'll try and get to bed by at least 11 o'clock. At least 11 o'clock, and then I'm up at 5. If you get the sleep bit right, you know, everything else falls into line, and that was okay. How it was for me.
And this is about eating as well, because sleeping...
Well, if you don't sleep right, you can't process food right.
Yeah.
So if you've got problems with depression or weight or, you know, even if you don't sleep enough, you're encouraging disease and cancer. So I think, you know, and then when you wake up, you know, you've got to start eating. And I think, I mean, I've always loved food. I think food is a joyful thing in a million ways. But I think in the last 2 years, I've studied nutrition and now I see food not just as pleasure and fuel, but also in gears, like in a car. And I think when you know the gears, it's so much easier to sort of bless yourself with energy or make yourself optimal and sharp and skin and emotions and all those things. So I feel like I've, the last 2 years, I mean, I went back to school. Yeah. I was rubbish at school, Adele, I was
Me
terrible.
Too.
I mean, I came out of school with an A in art, a C in geology, and everything else was ungraded. Like, it was... I did 5 years of special
but look
needs.
But look at you now.
Yeah.
So don't do well at school, that's the
point. No, don't do well at school. I tell you, I pay the price for not doing well at school now, cos you've got to do grown-up stuff, but...
So you went to school to learn nutrition?
Yeah, well, actually, the great thing about being in a position to ask two professors to come and teach me... So they come to my office, I do 3 hours every Friday. And it was a joy, and it made me love education again. Well, actually, for the first time.
Yeah.
I didn't like it the first time round. It wasn't right.
And one of the things that you learned about is superfood, as you call it.
Yeah. Well, I think like when you so there's like this emotional, understandably importantly emotional part of food, then there's the nutritional part. So the kind of the kind of chemistry behind it, what's going on. And then there's these areas of the world where people live the longest and live in higher proportion to their 90s and their 100s. And, you know, they're dancing and they're joyful and they're sprightly and they're full of life and they're still shagging in their 90s. Yes, in their 90s. The problem in this day and age, everyone associates loving food or having a good life with food with being rich. And they think it's a rich... You know, all of these areas of longevity... Are people that have very humble existences.
So what would be the ingredients of this kind of food?
Well, it's not about the ingredient, it's about the cluster of ingredients. So it's not like, you know, there's no one golden bullet. But when you start, you know, putting a plate of food together that's just full of optimal, like, goodness, your body's like, yeah, come on, like, give it to me. So, and of course, the naughty stuff, you know, is still great, you can still have it, but it's not like a religion that you've got to follow to the T. You can kind of bend the rules and change the gears a little bit.
And you've been doing this yourself. Have you changed? You've changed, haven't you?
Yeah, I've...
You're sort of less gravy, more salad-type looking.
Gravy's really good. I mean, gravy's actually quite good for you, bro. It's not that you can't have anything, it's just, like, how you put it together. So I think certainly in a lot of the modern world, and I've lived in the most unhealthy towns in the world, in America, in England, in Australia, and the consistency you get is all the plates look golden. They're all orange. It's all breadcrumbed. It's all battered. It's all khaki. So colour tells you everything. If it's colourful, you're probably 90%, 95% it's looking good. So colour's nature's way of telling you there's good stuff in here. And if it's golden, it's a treat.
But is this also a part of you becoming older?
I mean, definitely.
Being interested in this.
No, she's only 25, I'm 40.
I've started eating better since I had a child. I've started really taking care of myself, and
I think that's a natural reaction,
right? Yeah, I think it has a massive thing to do with it.
Do you make your own food?
I make my own food, but also, like, it's that Gears thing. I've never thought of it like that, but now he said it, that's exactly how I would think of it.
Let's have an hour. It's great, honestly. But I think that when you have a kid, and when I had my child, it changed my life, and I think there's nothing more human than watching a child physically get bigger through, like, breast milk, right?
Yeah.
And I think it's an incredible thing. So you
just want to live longer, though. You want to live as long as you can.
Yeah.
Didn't you?
Yeah, and in style. I mean, like when I went to this, there's this island called Ikaria in Greece, and you've got to go there. No one goes there. It's amazing. And the whole island's organic, just because everyone thinks organic is weird or flash or posh. Organics is normal, right? Mm-hmm. So, and you go in there, and they did a survey, and 80%. Of 60 to 100-year-old men have sex regularly and, wait for it, successfully. what I love.
Sugar, we all know it's kind of not good for us, but it's really so good.
OK, look.
I mean, it's...
Listen, look, do.
Before I come in here, I eat a lot of sugar just to get the energy.
Yeah, well, good on you. Sugar's amazing. I mean, we're programmed to love sugar. Yeah. You know, bees pollinate because, you know, nectar is sweet, right? And we should love it, and we should... But, like, you know, the thing is, it's a commodity that gets taken advantage of. So when you're putting honey on something, joy. Maple syrup, joy. Having a cake, joy. Yeah? Joy. I would never say don't eat cake because it's a joyful thing and it's an important part of life. But the thing is, that sort of nutrient gets misused across the whole industry. If you look at the percentage of sugar in all cereal for the last 40 years, right, and the adverts and the money and the sponsorships behind it, trouble. You know, it's riddled
it's
with sugar.
It's a hidden struggle.
Mate, when I was in America, in the most unhealthy town in America, right, and I was living there, right, I would go in, the milk had more total sugars than a can of Coke, right? And then they pour that on cereal, which is luminous, riddled with sugar. And then next to it is a Danish pastry of icing sugar next to it, and then there's a pizza for breakfast. And guess how old they are? Six, seven, eight. And about half of the kids have got problems with weight and getting bullied and getting behind in education. So it's a man-made problem. And in my view, I think adults for the last 40 years have done a terrible job of handing over the country to kids. That's the problem that we've got right now.
What about alcohol?
So,
he's a great politician, isn't he?
No,
yeah, he's a great politician.
Well, so if you want to know about alcohol, what do you want to know about it?
And I just wonder, what about yourself and alcohol? Do you?
I mean, love it.
You have sugar. You love it.
I just love it.
But you you've changed your eating. Have you changed your drinking?
Yeah, I generally. So the way I kind of get this is how I do it. Everyone has their own thing. Like I'm like right, work, responsibility, focus. Monday to Friday lunch, I'll try not to drink. Try not to drink. Right, Friday night. Let it all hang out. But here's the thing. So in my weird little life, Adele, like, so I'll write to people and I'll get, like, the best liver expert in the country to come. I'll cook them lunch. Jamie Oliver invites you, he'll cook your lunch, and can we talk about the liver for, like, 4 hours, right?
Okay.
And that's the stuff that makes me happy, right? So we sit him down and I go, right, and I ask the same question you did. Right, let's talk about alcohol. How much can you have? How does it work? What is the liver like, not like? And my first question was, if I don't have it Monday to Friday, can I total up all my units and have it at the weekend? He's like, no, it doesn't work like that. I'm like, damn.
You like drinking?
Yes.
I'm not allowed to drink because it dehydrates my vocal cords. It makes my my ears blocked. Then I talk louder and wear my voice out. So I can't drink anymore. And I used to drink 10 cups of tea a day with 2 sugars in. Really? 20 sugars I used to have a day.
Really?
Don't drink tea. And I've got more energy than ever.
But tell me, what about alcohol? You can drink alcohol?
No, I can't. No. Alcohol blocks your ears. When you get drunk, you really get leery, like... It makes you talk louder, so I can't do that because I might raise my voice and then...
Did you used to drink alcohol?
Oh, yeah. Mine was, like, Monday morning to Sunday night. Like, all the way through. Oh, the hair of the dog.
You've both met royal people before.
I met Prince Charles. Who have you met?
I've met Prince Charles and a few of the others.
You've met Queenie?
Yes, I have.
Have you?
Yeah, she's cool.
I got my MBE from Prince Charles and I was hoping it was the Queen, but then I thought, well, actually, it's pretty cool because Prince Charles being my kid's king.
Yeah.
So I thought that was all right.
Yeah, bless.
But, yeah. Well, I think he's met them all, like, proper.
Yeah. I've only met one of the boys.
OK.
But I would quite like to meet Kate and the baby. But look at what we're talking about. By the way,
this isn't a given.
Fascinating. The thing is that we're having a royal couple in here now.
I know.
And
have you met them before?
Well, yes, once.
Yeah,
you know?
They're very nice.
They're very not royal, aren't they?
Yeah, they're cool.
I didn't feel like...
We're taking them clubbing afterwards, then. We're going to have to
The thing is that people tend to get nervous or a bit stiff, you know, when you have people from royalty around. Is that your experience, or do you manage to be yourself totally relaxed?
I think, like, there's protocol and there's history, and I think there's ways that you can break through it, and as the person that is, you know, I mean, like when I got my MBE, I phoned up the palace and said, look, I don't know what to wear, and I said, what do I wear? And they said, the Queen would love you to wear whatever you're comfortable in, you know. So that's quite cool, right? And then I turn up without a tie and the press killed me, but...
I know, they made such a big deal out of me wearing a hat. They don't know you have to wear a hat. If you don't wear a hat, then they're gonna...
You had a hat?
You have to, like, to wear, like, a little veil. You have to wear something on your head.
OK.
We don't have to, though. She don't mind what you wear.
They might not for you, but for girls, they do. For women, you do.
Well, I didn't wear a tie.
But then you got slaughtered.
I know, but... Well, the press, not her.
No, I'm sure she doesn't care. I tripped over in front of Prince Charles and it just broke the ice. I, like, tripped over. I was like, oh, my God. And then we started talking and he was lovely, actually. He was really chilled. But also, I mean, I'm sure they have, like, really, like, naughty lives in real life. Not your royals.
Let's find out. Thank you so much, Jamie Oliver. Her er Prinsesse Madeleine og herr Chris O'Neill.